A red eye is like a warning light in your car. It's telling you that something is wrong, but how serious is it? I'm Dr. Jasper Trotter, board certified ophthalmologist, and we're gonna go through symptoms that can help you triage. Is this something that's likely benign and okay for a non-urgent follow-up? Or is this something that's potentially vision threatening that needs an urgent or emergent referral to an ophthalmologist? Before I walk through the two tiers, I want to share two key symptoms, whether or not there's been a vision change and pain. If either are present, then my level of concern goes up. Now, that's not to say that other symptoms are not as important, or if there isn't a vision change and there's no pain, that there's nothing serious going on, as you'll see in the rest of the video, so be sure to keep watching. But with pain, it's a clue that there's an active problem going on, like an inflammatory process, like an uveitis, or maybe there's sharp pain that's a result of an epithelial defect because there was a poke to the eye that led to a corneal abrasion. But there are many eye conditions that occur without pain, so it's not all or none, but rather an important guide. Vision change without pain takes me down one path. Vision change with pain takes me down a different path. So using it as a guide, the presence or absence of pain helps me with a differential diagnosis. The second key symptom is vision. So what I want to know is the vision normal? Is it at the patient's baseline? Or has there been a change or loss of vision? And the vision change can be anything new or different from their baseline. Blurry vision, a peripheral vision change like a curtain coming into the view, new floaters. If there's any vision change, I generally recommend that the patient see an eye doctor. You might be wondering, well, what kind of vision change warrants an emergent referral? Some examples include significant vision loss. Let's say a patient normally has 20/30 visual acuity, but now their hand motion, they can't see anything on a Snellen eye chart. A monocular patient who's losing vision in their good eye, a peripheral vision loss described as a curtain or veil, especially in the setting of new flashes of light and floaters, that's concerning for a retinal detachment. Also, transient vision loss, which can be for many causes, like a vascular cause. An example would be giant cell arteritis or temporal arteritis. A neurological cause, like a migraine. And it might also be a sign of an impending stroke. But sometimes what seems concerning may actually be due to a non-urgent issue, like dry eye or a refractive error. So you might be thinking, how in the world am I supposed to figure this out? This is why it can be really helpful to get the best corrected visual acuity. And the easiest way to do that is with a pinhole. It's quick, it's cheap, it's easy to use. I'll leave a link in the description if you want to check one out. So the pinhole helps to estimate how much the vision can improve with correction, so glasses or contact lenses. Let's say there's a patient who has mild redness, some dryness, but you're told that they have 20/200 visual acuity, which is quite a bit different from their baseline. But then with a pinhole, they improve to 20/25. Then they tell you at the end, oh my bad, I forgot my glasses at home. Should I bring them next time? A vision decline to 20/200 initially sounds urgent, like you gotta get on the phone, call ophthalmology right away. But then checking with pinhole to get the best corrected visual acuity, and now all of a sudden it's 20/25, well, that may have saved a patient, you know, a 2-hour trip to a hospital that has ophthalmology on call if you don't have local coverage. If you want to learn more about how to check a patient's visual acuity, I'll leave a link to this video down below in the description. But that's for later. Let's go ahead and talk about the two tiers, non-urgent follow-up versus urgent emergent referral to an ophthalmologist. First, tier one, non-urgent follow-up. So let's talk about some symptoms. Mild irritation or discomfort. Now, I'm not talking about pain, I'm talking about irritation. Think about the last time an eyelash was in your eye. It likely was annoying. It was irritating. It caught your attention because the eye is so sensitive. And the moment you remove the eyelash, you have immediate relief and it's, whew, thank goodness. And sometimes it can be helpful to clarify that with a patient because sometimes they may say that they're experiencing pain. And clarifying, is it pain or more irritation? And they say, oh, it's irritating, not really pain, but irritation. Then now you're going down this path versus, oh, it's a red eye with pain. Other symptoms include dryness, foreign body sensation, grittiness. That often happens in dry eye syndrome. Watery discharge or tearing, like in viral conjunctivitis, that often resolves on its own. Itchiness, assuming it's isolated to the eye or the eyelids and there's no concern for anaphylaxis. That's common in viral conjunctivitis. Also an allergy to an eye drop, like a glaucoma eye drop, or pollen, mold, etc. So that's often managed outpatient. An exception would be EKC, epidemic keratoconjunctivitis, which is a more severe type of adenoviral conjunctivitis. So EKC, I talk about this in a different video. I'll also leave that in the description as well. But because it is a more severe type, it can present with some findings on exam that may need treatment, that may need to be addressed sooner rather than later. Another exception is a pediatric patient that has, let's say, viral conjunctivitis. They have a lot of itchiness, they're rubbing their eyes. Let's say they have a lot of eyelid swelling that's blocking the visual access. Well, there could be a concern for amblyopia. So we want to make sure, just as a side note, for a kid, that the pupil is nice and open and not blocked, so there isn't any concern for amblyopia. Another symptom is eyelash crusting. So sometimes people will wake up in the morning, they'll have some matter, some crusting on the eyelashes. That generally is not urgent. It often is blepharitis. That's often managed with warm compresses, lid scrubs, etc. And if it doesn't improve or worsen, because it can lead to some irritation and some redness, then you can have the patient follow up with an eye doctor outpatient. When I'm thinking about, okay, is this okay for a non-urgent follow-up? It's not only which symptoms are present and how bad they are, it's also the absence of symptoms that's also important. You walk into a room, the patient has a red eye, and they tell you their symptoms, but you're also checking off what isn't there. There's no vision change or loss. There's no pain, no mucopurulent discharge, no double vision, light sensitivity, no new flashes of light or new floaters. This isn't a situation where there's a red eye and the patient has a headache, a brow ache, or nausea, vomiting. Those symptoms with an acute right eye, especially with blurry vision, think acute pupillary block. All of those are negative. Well, that is reassuring. And, you know, of course, pending the exam, can help us triage. Okay, I think we're under tier one here. So to recap, tier one, non-urgent follow-up. So overall mild presentation, there aren't any urgent signs or symptoms, and the presentation is not quickly worsening. In addition, the five eye vital signs are within normal. So when in doubt and trying to triage, remember the five eye vital signs that'll be listed here on the screen. If all of them are within normal, that is reassuring. Doesn't guarantee that there's not a problem, but again, we're adding more points into the, I think we're okay. Some example diagnoses include subconjunctival hemorrhage, dry eye syndrome, blepharitis, and routine viral conjunctivitis. Let's move on to tier two, urgent emergent referral. What we're really talking about are what are the warning symptoms to be aware of. So this is that case where you hear about it and you pause because you know something is off. There's something that's drawing your attention and it might need to be seen by an ophthalmologist today or at least very soon. So this is where my two key symptoms are coming back up, vision change and pain. For pain, what I'm listening for is pain described as sharp, deep ache, pain with eye movement, worsening pain, pain in the setting of a recent surgery or trauma. For example, let's say a patient had cataract surgery and they're coming in 3 days later with an acute red eye, worsening pain, rule out endophthalmitis. That's a vision-threatening infection. What can help when triaging a patient with eye pain is to have them close their eye and to keep their eye still. You could also put in a numbing drop in the eye and then ask the patient, does the pain go away or does it decrease? If it does, then that's a clue that there's likely something going on with the ocular surface. Look for epithelial loss, like in dry eye syndrome, a corneal abrasion, corneal ulcer. And that's where the exam can come in to help with the diagnosis. But if closing the eye or a numbing drop does not alleviate the pain, then it's less likely due to the ocular surface and coming from somewhere else, like the sclera and scleritis or the optic nerve and optic neuritis. Other warning symptoms include vision change or loss, photophobia, especially new photophobia. Also, mucopurulent discharge. Now, the presence of this alone doesn't equate to an urgent ophthalmology consult, so it's case by case. Mild acute bacterial conjunctivitis is often self-limiting. If there aren't any urgent concerns, the patient could likely follow up with an optometrist or ophthalmologist within days, sooner if there's any concerns. Compare that to hyperacute bacterial conjunctivitis like in gonococcal conjunctivitis. There's significant mucopurulent discharge, it can move quickly and can involve the cornea. That needs treatment and warrants an emergent ophthalmology referral. So it depends on the case. Other symptoms, a new headache, brow ache, nausea, vomiting in a patient with a red eye. That could be due to high eye pressure. New double vision. Now, I'm not talking about ghosting where an object, you can kind of see a shadow and you blink a few times and it can clear up, but two separate images. And it can be really helpful to know whether or not it's monocular diplopia, so a patient covers the eye and they're still experiencing the double vision, or if it's binocular diplopia, both eyes are open, that's when they experience a double vision, you cover an eye and then it goes away. And this is where the exam can be very helpful, especially the five eye vital signs. In a case of new double vision, checking the eye motility, that may reveal that the patient can't look to the right in one eye and they have a cranial nerve palsy. Symptoms leave breadcrumbs. So even though examining a patient with a red eye can definitely be daunting, take a step back. Is there any vision change? Is there pain? Are there any other alarm symptoms? Are the symptoms stable? Are they quickly worsening? Ultimately, how worried does this patient make me? When in doubt, err on the side of caution and have the patient seen by an eye doctor as soon as possible. Now, I briefly mentioned viral conjunctivitis. If you want to learn more, watch this next, but be sure to click subscribe. See you in the next video.